Mina, Kombanwa, Jesus Freaking Gamer here. I'm getting the Sunday message out on time today, doggone it, as well as the video game video. So let's hop right into it. This one is going to be part four. Oh my gosh, four parts on heaven. Hey, majoring on heaven though, I don't really mind that. I'm very glad and very happy that I've been able to cover this subject very thoroughly and very completely. That is a very, very good thing that I'm just very happy that I've been able to do. It's great to dwell on the positive things, and don't get much better than eternal paradise. So we've talked all about resurrection, we've talked about judgment, we've talked about the eternal states to a degree. We're going to cover a little bit more of that, and we're going to talk in detail about heaven itself. Now first off, what is heaven? What is the definition of the term heaven? Because even the Bible mentions more than one heaven. So let's cover that and from there go into the other details. First off, there is a physical heaven. You look up. There it is. Go to Genesis chapter 1, verses 6 through 10. In case you didn't know, that's the first book of the Bible. Genesis 1, 6 through 10. Just a little sarcasm there. I think everyone knows Genesis is the first book of the Bible. Is there anyone who doesn't know that literally anywhere in the world? Unless they had never heard of the Bible, never heard of Christianity or Judaism, only then would they not be aware of Genesis. It's so cool, the fact that most people know at least a few things and at least have heard something about the Bible. As a Christian, that makes me extremely happy. So again, Genesis chapter 1, verses 6 through 10. And God said, "Let there be a firmament in the midst of the waters, and let it divide the waters from the waters." So we got two sets of water here. "Thus God made the firmament, and divided the waters which were under the firmament from the waters which were above the firmament, and it was so. And God called the firmament heaven." Boom, we have one thing dividing the waters from the waters from the waters. The waters on top and the waters underneath. "And the firmament that divided them was called heaven. So the evening and the morning were the second day. Then God said, let the waters under the heavens be gathered together into one place, and let the dry land appear. And it was so. And God called the dry land earth, and the gathering together of the waters he called seas. And God saw that it was good. So we have earth, where we have, and of course the earth itself is the dry land, and then we have the water underneath the firmament, that's the seas, and then the waters up above the firmament, that's heaven. So the sky is heaven. Boom, there it is. There's a heaven right there that we can all see. Now, of course, that doesn't cover everything. By no means. Like, okay, well, that's heaven. What about the whole eternal state of heaven and stuff like that? I'm going to progress into that with a bit of a segue. Yeah, I think it wouldn't really be completely just, and I wouldn't have completely covered heaven if I didn't cover the concept of the third heaven. It's that the third heaven is mentioned one time in the entire Bible, and there's a lot of debate on what that is. So let me go right into that. The third heaven is mentioned in 2 Corinthians chapter 12, verses 2 through 4. 2 Corinthians chapter 12, verses 2 through 4. I'm actually going to go back into the Old Testament in just a second, but let's read this first. This is Paul speaking. "I know a man in Christ who 14 years ago, whether in the body, I do not know, or whether out of the body, I do not know, God knows, such a one was caught up to the third heaven. And I know such a man, whether in the body or out of the body, I do not know, God knows, how he was caught up into paradise and heard inexpressible words, which it is not lawful for a man to utter." So, third, again, only time in the entire Bible a third heaven is mentioned. So that makes you think, okay, well, there must be two other heavens, I guess. It would make sense. Could there be more than two heavens? But apparently this third heaven can be equated with paradise. Technically, they could be more than one place. I don't hold to that view, and I don't think many people hold to that view. If you can find anyone who holds to the view that paradise and the third heaven are not the same place, leave not a link, but like a comment in the comment section down below, and like say, you know, Google this. I don't like links in the description down below, so just say like, hey, Google blah, 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 and it'll find you a link to someone who disagrees with that. But I personally believe the third heaven and paradise are the exact same thing. Now, there are hints about multiple heavens or a high heaven in the Old Testament. So I'm going to go into that, and then I will describe what I think this whole third heaven thing means. There are two main theories. One is really popular, one not as popular. I'll cover both of what I think about that in just a minute. But for now, let's go to Deuteronomy chapter 10, verse 14. Deuteronomy chapter 10, verse 14. By the way, these Sunday messages where I don't talk about just one particular chapter, but even my weekly messages where I'm like, okay, I'm in the book of blah, 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 blah. For anyone who isn't familiar with the Bible like I am, please feel free to open up the table of contents in your Bible. With Google, you can simply look it up, whatever. But if you have a good old book, I love the flipping of pages. I've mentioned that many, many, many times. I love to actually flip through the Bible and know where the books of the Bible are for myself. Please don't be ashamed to use the table of contents. We've all got to start somewhere. We've all got to learn from the beginning. None of us just start out as a master. All of us, excuse me. All of us start out at the beginning. All of us start out as a noob. You want to learn the Bible? You've got to study it. You want to know where the books of the Bible are? You look at a list of the books of the Bible and you literally just say it over and over again until you've memorized it. That's what I did. And anyone who has memorized the books of the Bible, that's what they had to do as well. So please don't be ashamed to do that. I feel like that was an important segue. I referenced like this, 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 and this, and I just turn right to it. Don't feel bad if you can't do that. Practice. Take the time to learn it. Take the time to memorize it. That's how I did it. That's why I am proficient in it now, because I took the time to study. That's the only way anyone can be good at anything. So don't be ashamed. Just start at the beginning. And back to heaven, Deuteronomy 10:14. Indeed, heaven and the highest heavens belong to the Lord your God, also the earth with all that is in it. So there is heaven and the highest heavens. So we have a third heaven is, again, it's only mentioned one time in the scriptures, but apparently there's more than one heaven mentioned. Apparently the sky we see above us, the dividing of the firmaments, apparently there's more to it than just that. Also corroborating this is 1 Kings 8:27. Whoop. 1 Kings 8:27. Oh, went past it. 1 Kings 8:27. This is Solomon's prayer of dedication to his temple. But will God indeed dwell in the earth? Behold, heaven, and the heaven of heavens cannot contain you. How much less this temple which I have built? So heaven and the heaven of heavens, the greatest of heavens, the pinnacle of heaven. Again, God doesn't live in the sky. He lives somewhere else. And to say that he lives somewhere higher, it's a little bit ridiculous to me to think, okay, just keep going up, go up a little bit more, keep on going, boom, there you got it, there's God. The whole idea of up is metaphoric. The fact that God is higher than us, above us, greater than us, something that we cannot reach. That's the entire point. Heaven, now, is it possible that outside of this reality and somewhere beyond space, not above space, because space just kind of goes in all directions outside of the earth, that somewhere outside of this physical reality, there's heaven? Well, it's possible. The spiritual realm, and this is a subject I didn't prepare to speak on. I'll talk about it just briefly. Once again, if you have requests or questions, feel free to leave it in the comments down below. Some questions are worth a good response, a good 30-minute response. Oh, good grief. Maybe it's my asthma. Maybe that's why I yawn so much when I talk for an extended period of time. I do apologize for that. Even if I had good editing software and was the master editor, I don't think I would edit out these yawns. I can't edit them out when I stand before a congregation, and I don't know, I kind of feel like this is my church. I'm not the head of any church, I'm not like ordained or anything, but it's my YouTube channel, and I can say what I want. So I kind of feel like this is my platform, this is my podium or pulpit, as you will. And I don't want to edit this down. You know, I want if I go a little bit over, then doggone it, I went a little bit over. And if I end it a little bit early, like that'll ever happen, then I end early. But I don't want to edit that out. This is my pulpit right here, and I, even if really no one at the moment at all is watching it, I like having this. So the spiritual realm is on top of the physical realm. Like angels and demons are like, you know, we can't see them on camera. I can't see them with my eyes. But those beings and the spiritual realm itself is layered on top of this world. They coexist. Like we always think of ghosts, for example, spirits going through walls and whatnot. In the same way, angels and demons, by the way, ghosts aren't a thing. When a human dies, they, as I've covered in the previous message, I believe they're immediately judged. And even if you don't believe the judgment's immediate, that spirit doesn't linger here on earth. It goes to heaven or hell, or as a minority of people believe, that soul simply sleeps. But ghosts aren't real. In the Bible, it mentions the word ghost, but every time someone thought they saw a ghost, it wasn't a ghost. A lot of times, it was actually the apostles saying they saw a ghost on the water, and it was Jesus. But anyway, the spiritual realm is layered on top of the physical realm. So there are angels and demons. There are probably, considering I'm a believer in Christ, there are probably some angels in this room right now. My guardian angel, and I personally believe through a personal revelation that guardian angels are a thing. They're not mentioned in the Bible, so feel free to disagree with me on that. That's purely a spiritual experience that I have had one time when I was in the hospital. And I was just very concerned about what was going on at the time. I just immediately knew that my guardian angel was right there. And that there's no way to prove that physically. It's an angel. Come on. There's no way to prove that, but I know what I felt. I know the knowledge that passed through my mind at that time. I knew that I knew that I knew that I had a guardian angel. I have no doubt he is right there with me. There might be several other angels. This is the property where I live is a Christian property. It's prayed over often. I have no doubt that there are several angels in the room right now that I cannot see. I really don't doubt that. So they're here. We just can't physically perceive them because the spiritual realm is not in this realm. So God's heaven could be within this physical reality. Maybe space really truly does go out forever. Although scientists, a lot of them say that space is expanding. So maybe the spiritual heaven of God is outside of space-time altogether. I tend to believe that. None of this is in the Bible. All of this is opinion. None of it can be proven. And since the Bible doesn't talk about it, it's not overly important. But nonetheless, it's worth to note. It's worth to talk about. It's worth thinking about. It's good to branch out and theorize and, you know, see what we think on these things. The important thing is what the Bible says is true, and we believe what that says. So there is a third heaven, which is paradise, and there is a greater heaven. Apparently, it's the third heaven where God dwells. Now, what are the three heavens? That's kind of the next question. That's the next thing that would progress into this. I don't know why I'm yelling this much. Gee whiz. Breathe. Doggone it, lungs, work. I really don't feel tired right now. I'm breathing okay. Stop yawning, doggone it. Listen to me, body. No more yawns, you hear me? Anyway, total distraction there. The three heavens, what is that? The most popular theory of what the three heavens are is the first heaven is, boom, sky. What we all can see right there. Second heaven, boom, space. Again, something else all of us can see, especially at night when we see all the stars in the sky, and especially if you have something like a telescope, and if you want to, just go online. Plenty of pictures of space, the stars, galaxies, dark matter, etc. We can see that. And then there would be the third heaven, where God himself abides. That's the most popular theory. There is another theory espoused by not as many, that view the heavens more as dispensations of time. The first heaven would be the Garden of Eden, the innocence of man prior to the fall. The second heaven would be where we're living right now in this sinful, fallen world, where sin is allowed, where sin sometimes looks like it is reigning and having its way. Then there is the third heaven, where Jesus will rule and where everything will be under him and under his direct command and through him in God the Father. So that's the eternal state of heaven, which will be talked about later on in this message. Which of the two do I believe? Where do I stand in that particular debate or dispute? I honestly do not know. I've thought about it. Both have their strong points. The more popular one being, you know, just, you know, sky, space, and then God's heaven, the throne of God. It's because I can see two of them. There's a lot of appeal in that thought. And that's probably one of the reasons why I tend to think God's heaven, while the spiritual realm is a part of this world, I tend to think of God's heaven. So much for my body listening to me. I tend to think of God's heaven as being separate, removed, above this current reality, which is very sin-filled. The three dispensations of time, the first, as long as you believe that the Bible is the Word of God, which every Christian does, it's not hard to subscribe to the second theory. We have the Garden of Eden. It's recorded in Genesis. We have the current sinful realm, which the rest of the Bible talks about, except for when it talks about the resurrection and the judgment. Good chunk of the Bible is dealing with the here and the now, the second heaven. And then there's the third heaven, which all Christians believe will go to a heaven when we die. So both theories have their strong points. Both theories have an appeal. Maybe a blend of the two is correct. Kind of like my view on the end of days. I don't really have a subscribe to any particular theory. I see a little bit of truth in all of them. At this point, I really do feel like I need to apologize. I wish I knew how to turn that off. That is so annoying. Maybe it's because I'm sitting down, and my lungs just don't. Since I'm talking so much, my lungs just need more air. Anyway, maybe when I stand up, it won't be an issue if I ever have an actual pulpit one day. Anyway, I apologize for that. All past yawns, present yawns, and future yawns. The first, second, and third seasons of yawns. Ugh. Anyway, I like both theories. I subscribe to parts of both. And really, since I mentioned earlier, I tend to believe that God's heaven is something separate from this current sinful reality. And I certainly believe that there's going to be an eternal heaven down the road. I really subscribe fully to both theories. Both, I believe, are completely accurate. So yeah, I believe in both 100%. So what is this third heaven, this heaven of heavens? The heaven that we Christians talk about going to when we die, that place where the righteous go on to shine like the stars forever. There are some questions as to how heaven's going to work out, and that is going to be, I'm like, how should I approach this? Let's approach it this way. You know that verse about, you know, the lion laying down with the lamb? Like, you know, this just peaceful, wonderful, perfect state of being? First of all, that's wrong. Go to Isaiah chapter 11, and we'll start at verse 1. Isaiah chapter 11, starting at verse 1. And we're going to read, now there's going to be a lot of Bible reading from this point on in the message, so I don't have to think about crafting words or really doing much explaining, because a lot of the things that the Bible, that Christians believe about heaven, really doesn't require much explanation. I just need to read those verses. So let's go to Isaiah chapter 11, starting at verse 1. There shall come forth a rod from the stem of Jesse, and a branch shall grow out of his roots. Now that basically referring to a son of David, which Jesus was, the Messiah. The Spirit of the Lord shall rest upon him, the Spirit of wisdom and understanding, the Spirit of counsel and might, the Spirit of knowledge and of the fear of the Lord. His delight is in the fear of the Lord, and he shall not judge by the sight of his eyes, nor decide by the hearing of his ears. But with righteousness he shall judge the poor, and decide with equity for the meek of the earth. He shall strike the earth with the rod of his mouth, and with the breath of his lips he shall slay the wicked. Righteousness shall be the belt of his loins, and faithfulness the belt of his waist. The wolf also shall dwell with the lamb, not the lion. The leopard shall lie down with the young goat, the calf and the young lion. So it's the lion and the cow, and the fatling together. The calf and the young lion and the fatling together. And a little child shall lead them. A little child shall lead them is also a semi-popular verse. So all this is right here batched together. The cow and the bear shall graze. Their young ones shall lie down together. And the lion shall eat straw like the ox. The nursing child shall play by the cobra's hole. And the weaned child shall put his hand in the viper's den. They shall not hurt nor destroy in all my holy mountain. For the earth shall be full of the knowledge of the Lord as the waters cover the sea. I feel so full reading that. I just kind of want to bask in the brilliance and the glory of that right there. Now, there are some questions in regards to the timing of heaven and how exactly heaven is going to work. Some theories will state that God will literally just revamp this world. And then there are some theories that God will rule here temporarily, and then this world will be destroyed, and then the eternal state of heaven and hell, or more specifically, the New Jerusalem, heaven, and the lake of fire into which hell will be thrown in, that will happen. And then some people simply believe that there won't be anything to do with this earth, that this earth will be immediately destroyed at the end of time upon Jesus' return, and that we will go from there immediately into the eternal states of heaven and hell, or the New Jerusalem and the lake of fire. So let's read the verses in question. Let's go there. That's going to be Revelation 19:11, and then I'll basically almost to the end of the book of Revelation. So that's a lot of reading. There's a lot to cover. And we're about to reel in this entire thing. We're about to wrap this entire thing up, guys. So again, Revelation 19:11. Revelation 19:11. Here we are, Revelation 19, verse 11. So I'm going to be reading for a while here. And a lot of this, a lot of things will simply spell themselves out in the end. Now I saw heaven opened, and behold, a white horse. And he who sat on him was called Faithful and True. And in righteousness he judges and makes war. Sound familiar? His eyes were like a flame of fire, and on his head were many crowns. He had a name written that no one knew except himself. He was clothed with a robe dipped in blood, and his name is called the Word of God. In case, and if that doesn't make it very obvious, let me just tell you, we're talking about Jesus here. And the armies in heaven, clothed in fine linen, white and clean, followed him on white horses. Now out of his mouth goes a sharp sword, that with it he should strike the nations, and he himself will rule them with a rod of iron. He himself treads the winepress of the fierceness and wrath of Almighty God. And he has on his robe and on his thigh a name written, King of Kings and Lord of Lords. Then I saw an angel standing in the sun, and he cried with a loud voice, saying to all the birds that fly in the midst of heaven, Come and gather together for the supper of the great God, that you may eat the flesh of kings, the flesh of captains, the flesh of mighty men, the flesh of horses and of those who sit on them, and the flesh of all people, free and slave, both small and great. So lots of birds of prey are being gathered for quite the battle here. And I saw the beast, that's the Antichrist, the kings of the earth and their armies gathered together to make war against him who sat on the horse and against his army. Then the beast was captured, and with him the false prophet who worked signs in his presence, by which he deceived those who received the mark of the beast and those who worshipped his image. These two were cast alive into the lake of fire burning with brimstone. And the rest were killed with the sword which proceeded from the mouth of him who sat on the horse. And all the birds were filled with their flesh. Moving into chapter 20, verse 1. Then I saw an angel coming down from heaven, having the key to the bottomless pit and a great chain in his hand. He laid hold of the dragon, that serpent of old, who is the devil and Satan. So lots of, if you're reading the book of Revelation, You're seeing a lot of things just kind of tied in together here. Like the devil, Satan, the serpent of old, the serpent who deceived Adam and Eve, the dragon referred to in the book of Revelation. All these are the same being and bound him for 1,000 years. And he cast him into the bottomless pit and shut him up and set a seal on him so that he should deceive the nations no more till the 1,000 years were finished. But after these things, he must be released for a little while. And I saw thrones, and they sat on them, and judgment was committed to them. Then I saw the souls of those who had been beheaded for their witness to Jesus and for the word of God, who had not worshipped the beast or his image, and had not received his mark on their foreheads or on their hands. And they lived and reigned with Christ for 1,000 years. But the rest of the dead did not live again until the 1,000 years were finished. This is the first resurrection. Blessed and holy is he who has part in the first resurrection. Over such, the second death has no power, but they shall be priests of God and of Christ, and shall reign with him 1,000 years. And when the 1,000 years have expired, Satan will be released from his prison and will go out to deceive the nations which are in the four corners of the earth, Gog and Magog, to gather them together to battle, whose number is as the sand of the sea. They went up on the breadth of the earth and surrounded the camp of the saints and the beloved city. And fire came down from God out of heaven and devoured them. The devil who deceived them was cast into the lake of fire and brimstone, where the beast and the false prophet are, and they will be tormented day and night forever and ever. And I'll say, and actually, the rest of chapter 20 kind of wraps up the end of this 1,000 years. So let me read that. Then I saw a great white throne and him who sat on it, from whose face the earth and the heaven fled away, and there was found no place for them. And I saw the dead, small and great, standing before God, and books were opened. And another book was opened, which is the book of life. And the dead were judged according to their works, by the things which were written in the books. The sea gave up the dead who were in it, and death and Hades delivered up the dead who were in them. And they were judged, each one according to his works. Then death and Hades were cast into the lake of fire. This is the second death. And anyone not found written in the book of life was cast into the lake of fire. And that was the end of chapter 19 and all of Revelation chapter 20. And that goes into the eternal states. And holy smoke, still not enough time to finish. Holy smoke. I will never finish one of these things early, y'all. I say never. It might happen. It's possible. But just as how much I speak and how much there is to cover, it's so unlikely. So I'm like, should I do a smut? I like, there's some left. Maybe if I did a heaven part, I feel like it's a little bit too long to cover. It's just one of my little, 3 to 5, although sometimes I stretch all the way out to 8 and 10 minutes, messages during the week. I feel like this is one more message. So let's make a heaven part 5. Let's do this next Sunday. Let's wrap this up. I'll have one message under 30 minutes. It could be next Sunday because I'm almost done. I've almost brought this home. Just need to talk about the various views, the timing of things one last time, and then I can read about all the wonderful things that all Christians agree are in heaven itself, the final heaven, however you want, the third heaven, how paradise, however you want to word it. For now, I'd like to take the last minute and a half, it's going to go a little bit over, to talk to those who are thinking right now, whatever the timing of all this is, I'm not going to heaven. There's no way. Jesus Christ died on the cross for you, and he rose again 3 days later, and he offers forgiveness for all the things you've done wrong. I don't care how bad they are or how bad you think they are. I'm going to say this on camera and on YouTube. I don't care if you've killed somebody. God can forgive that. God can make even that horrible sin clean. He can forgive you for that. Probably be a good idea to turn yourself into the police and be completely honest afterwards about what you've done. There are some unsolved murders that need to be taken care of. And if you're willing to repent of this sin and commit your life to God, I would highly recommend in many what you've done to your local authorities. Something that serious and that severe, I'd personally say you deserve death for what you did at the exact and at the same time. I would say if you accept Jesus as your Lord and Savior, when you die, when you are killed like you deserve to be, you will stand before God, and even that sin will be cleansed. There, guys, there, I'm using the most extreme example, and I am talking to anyone watching this video, anyone who might have murdered somebody. Seriously, God can forgive even that sin. Even that severe of a sin, God can forgive. There's no one who can't be forgiven. There's no one who has to stand before God condemned to hell. Anyone can be forgiven. All you need to do is believe that Jesus died on the cross for you and rose again from the dead. If you will believe those things and tell God those things and that you want his forgiveness, you will be saved and you will go to heaven. If you want a model prayer to follow, pray this prayer after me. Say, Lord Jesus, I admit I'm a sinner. I've done wrong things. I've done evil things. But I believe you died on the cross, shedding your blood to forgive my sins. And I believe you rose again 3 days later, guaranteeing me eternal life in heaven. Please forgive me right now. Please wash me in your blood, Jesus. And please make me your child. Thank you for hearing this prayer. Thank you so much, God. Amen. And if you prayed that prayer, I can promise you, based on this, the Word of God, all of your sins are forgiven. Your name is written in the Lamb's Book of Life, and you will go to heaven when you die. Even if you deserve to be killed for doing some horrible thing, regardless of what it is, even murder, you will go to heaven when you die if you said that prayer from the bottom of your heart. Again, if you've done something that severe, I would encourage you to turn yourself into the police. Let them know what happened. Let them know the details. And if you are executed for that sin, which I still, again, believe you deserve to be, you will be in heaven with Jesus when you die. I know that could kind of be its own message altogether, but I felt at the end, I wanted to stress, any sin can be forgiven. No one has to be exempted from heaven. I wanted to really, really push that. And if you did accept Jesus, you are going to heaven. Your sins are forgiven, and you're my brother or my sister in Christ right now, and it is good. Regardless of where you've been and what you've done, it is good to have you as a part of the family. Can I encourage you? One, if you've done something that serious, again, please turn yourself into the police. I know that's rough, and I know that's hard, and under some circumstances, that's the end of your free life. But for sins that severe, please turn yourself in. For those who have done something less severe than that, and if you've done something less severe than that, you are still a sinner and you still need to be forgiven, I would like to encourage you, please find a church to find other believers who can encourage you in this new walk in Christ. It's great to have people who can come up alongside you, be your friend, and can still love you. In fact, actually, regardless of where you are, whether it's in prison or whether it's free, there are churches in prison. Join the church there. Be a part of that. Read the Word of God. That's also allowed in prison. Learn how your God thinks. Learn what's on His heart. Learn what it is what He wants you to do and how He wants you to live. And this is something you can also do whether you're free or in prison. Pray to your God every day. Just a simple, God, thank you so much for this beautiful day, or God, this sucks. I need your help. Both are prayers that God hears and answers equally. So guys, that's it. Look forward to Heaven Part 5. Holy smoke, we're going all the way with this thing. Look forward to it next Sunday. Thank you very much for watching this video. I was like, should I do Heaven or the Omnipresence of God? No, I'm going to do Heaven next Sunday. It's definitely going to be Heaven next Sunday. So thank you guys very much for watching this video. I love you. God bless.